The title of this sharing this morning is, It's Not About Us or Others or Us for Others, It's About Him. And it will be the last time that I share on it being about Jesus. We're going to start with Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. Colossians chapter 1. Colossians 1, 16, and we'll read down through 19. Ready? Speaking of Jesus, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things. And by him all things consist or are held together. And he is the head of the body, the church, he who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. And if you would, turn with me now to Gospel of John, chapter 11. And I want to, by the blessing of the Holy Spirit, I'd like to show you Jesus' heart a little more. I think that, again, so much of the time when we are reading Scripture, somehow we're looking for us in there. We're looking for us, and this is the story of Lazarus being raised, and I shared on this another time, and I also shared on this, I think in Ireland, yeah. So this is now my third time, so I should be raised from the dead soon. For example, in this story, what do you have? Well, you got Jesus, and you got the disciples, and you've got Martha, and you've got Mary, and you've got Lazarus, and you got the people that are observing, that say some things in the process of this thing. You got all these people, and we're trying to figure out who we are. Okay, but the Bible says, "For ye are dead, and your life." is hid with Christ in God, and when he appears, then your life appears. And that verse doesn't say when the king appears. This is not the soon coming king. This is your life, when he who is your life appears. This is a process. When he begins to appear in you as life, you begin to realize, you know, that I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, Christ liveth in me. You begin to read things, you begin to identify with him instead of, you know, well, I'm like Peter, you know. Well, yeah, but Peter was crucified with Christ also, you know. And I'm like Paul, you know, or somebody. We pick somebody that, you know, I'm like David. We pick somebody that we really admire, and that's who we're like, of course. You know, very few of us go, you know, I'm like Judas. I really am, you know. Which is, you know, we pick somebody we like. little do you know. But anyway, let's move on. And because of our viewpoint and seeing things from an us perspective, we just flat miss the heart of Jesus. And it's just as evident as it can be. I remember a couple of weeks ago, maybe a little longer than that, that I was sharing in our, I think, Thursday night Bible class, and I was talking about the scripture that says, you know, to lay not up for you things, you know, things in the earth, but lay up treasures in heaven. And then I started addressing this fact that if somebody broke in and took your most prized possessions, you know, your things, you would go, Lord, this isn't fair. This isn't right. This is wrong. Somebody offended me. Somebody took my stuff. And he would say, I told you not to lay up treasures in the earth. Why are you disobeying me? Why are you going contrary to me? You know, and but we never see it like that. We, as soon as something's stolen, we don't go, well, he told me. We don't. We are the injured party. We're separate from him. We don't really have his heart in the matter, so we, you know, and we miss Jesus. And that's just a dumb example, but hopefully it helps you remember some of the things that the Lord has shared with me over the years, that it's just sad. I mean, we just miss Jesus and we miss his heart, and we're always caught up in the circumstances of the thing as outside of him, and therefore you can't, he doesn't show everything. But I think there's some wonderful things in this story, and we've talked about them a little bit before, but I felt like this is what the Lord wanted me to close out this year with. This is John chapter 11, and let's begin with verse 1. Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Okay, so do we know who this Mary is? This is Mary of Bethany. This is the one that this banner is supposed to portray to us. And this is the one that demonstrated memorial ministry, demonstrated it, and gives us a clue as to what it's about. So we have to keep that in mind, because that's involved in this story. And then verse 3, therefore his sister sent unto him, unto Jesus, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. The one you love, Jesus, is sick. In verse 4, when Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Verse 5, now Jesus loved, here it is again, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So verse 6, when he heard that, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Okay, so both, we've got two verses that say he loved, it's included in Lazarus, but he loves this family. He loves Martha and he loves Mary, and he loves them. And when he heard that Lazarus was sick and this would affect the family and those that he loved, he stayed there for 2 days. Well, he didn't love them then. Jesus didn't love them. If he loved them, he would have been right there. He'd be Jesus on the spot. He would have been right here, because his job is to minister to my every need. And when things go bad, he's supposed to show up. So either he doesn't love them, which means the Bible is false. I mean, you know, this thing can go way back here. So we're going to have to figure out what the deal is. Or he does love them and stays back. Stays back for what? Death. Amen? Still with me? Don't worry, the season's almost over. Don't worry. Whom thou lovest, sick. And it says, when he heard that, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Then after that, saith he to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. Okay. Now, what I want to start with is this fact that Jesus said this sickness is not unto death. Now, we know that that Lazarus died. Okay? He died, you know. And I've told you many times before, you know, don't ever pray over me when I'm sick. This sickness is not unto death, because I'll probably die. But we never know, you know, I know Christians who've been, I know pastors, ministers who've been ministers for years and years and years, and they quote this all the time and yet never notice that Lazarus died. But he did, and he died because Jesus wanted him to die. I mean, I'll let you wrestle with all the facts of this, you know, but apparently that was it. If you find a better answer, share it with me. But that's the answer that this whole context is going to stay with. It's going to stay with it. I mean, it's really going to stay with it. So, and it says when he heard that he stayed 2 days more. All right. So, but I want you to notice also in verse 44. Look at verse 44. And he that was dead, this is Lazarus, he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go. A little bit of a long verse, but the main thing I want you to notice is he that was dead. The short version of that was, he was dead. He that was dead. He was dead. Dead. He dead. You get it? He died. So, we have to start examining what Jesus meant by that it's not unto death. That it's not unto death. Now, I believe in the end, God intends that we live, that we have life. But folks, it's supposed to be Jesus' life. Okay? So it's not unto death if it becomes Christ in you. If it becomes Christ, it becomes his life, then it's not unto death. It might include death. And we're talking about physical death here, but that can be spiritually, you know, you understand what I'm talking about. But Jesus knows, and he'll say it later, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Right here in these verses, that's where that comes from, because he knows what he's talking about, and we don't. And they, let's just put it that way, and they don't. They don't get it yet. They don't understand his words. They don't understand his actions, because they don't understand the heart. They don't understand the heart of the Lamb, which is that there be a death, but that there also be a life after death. Not in some day in heaven, but that Christ be formed in us now. And this is the way he thinks. So this is the way he talks, and this is the way that he'll talk throughout this thing. So in Jesus, death is not unto death. It may include death, but it's not unto death, it's unto life. And he is that life, okay? So, okay, well, if the end goal is life, then why does he allow this death? That's the key, that's the question, that's the right question you should be asking. Why does he allow this death? Or why does he allow us to go through deaths? Why does he allow that? Paul said something about it. In fact, his wording, I think it's over in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, And he says, in deaths often, I've been thrown into prison, I've been thrown into the sea, I've been thrown in deaths often. Okay. Another place he says, as dying and yet we live. See. So there's something to this, because the Bible just keeps hammering this reality. And most Christians, if they were put in this situation in chapter 11, they wouldn't understand it either, because they don't know his heart, and they're not going to tune in to his heart in this situation. And it's going to be, as it were, and I'll just say it like this, it's going to be disastrous for Jesus. And I'll explain that as we go here. So, verse 4 here says, when Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death. Not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. The Son of God being glorified by death. Unto life, his life. This is the goal. This is the heart of what Christianity, if you want to, you know, what Christianity, this is the heart of what we should be about. He must increase and I must decrease. Not I, but Christ. Not about I, but Christ. Let's see. And how does that come about? Well, a death. I am crucified with Christ. That he doesn't just say, okay, it's not you. He doesn't just say, it's not you, it's me. He says, not you, I am crucified. That's how come it, or that's how it is not you. You don't, self doesn't just go, okay, it's not me, it's going to be about Jesus. Good luck with that. My God, the flesh, it doesn't take long at all. It doesn't, you know, you turn the flesh loose and you can have a whole season of it being about Jesus, and you'll make it all about you, mostly. Thank God for moments. Thank God for precious moments that we turn and we say, oh, it's about you. I feel it. Until you get out. Side of church and everything, and then it's about you. See? That's why death is so important in the economy of God, or the way the Lamb operates. And guess what? The Lamb bought it all through death. See, he didn't just pull out the big guns, blow Satan away, blow away all the demons, kill everybody that he didn't like, and say, I'm king. Anybody got a problem with that? See, that's not the Lamb of God. That's us. Anybody here from Texas? And you know what I'm talking about. Because it takes Jesus in us. It does. So, also you remember that over in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, it talks about, and Paul's talking about this operation that works in. Now, death worketh in me, and worketh means a continuous process. Death is constantly working in me, but life in you. And that's what the scriptures say. But there is a purpose for the Son of God to be glorified in this death. Death worketh in me, but life is Christ to you. I bear about in my body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also. There is no life. I know that we think, well, yes, there is, you know. Yes. Once you get saved, you got life. Well, that life came out of death. Jesus is death. And we're supposed to be his body. And his body is supposed to bear a portion of this, just like it did at Calvary. But oh, I mean, just look at Calvary. My God, look at him hanging there. And a centurion, Roman centurion with a spear, shoves it in his side, and he's already dead. And they said he was already dead. You're already dead. He's already dead. Don't worry about it. He's dead. Well, let's do this. Shoves it in his side, and a river, river of life, river flows, a river starts coming out. And it's reached all of us if we're born again. That same blood has washed away our sins. But greater than that, that death was our death. And that's what most people don't see. That was our death. Not just he died for me and so that my sins would be forgiven and it would still be me. But there on Calvary, if you could see, if you stood there and you could see, you wouldn't just see an innocent man accused and wrongly accused and really horribly treated for nothing just because of jealousy and fears and, you know, all this kind of stuff that is us. You would see someone who willingly gave himself and took us into himself. And there, that's my death too. Thank you, Jesus. So this thing of death is being worked on. We're the death, but Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Amen? He's also the life. That's what. And if there's been a death without him becoming the life also, then it's just we call it a faith death, but it's just a fake death, because the real death is us going down into death. That's what water baptism represents. You're dead. Jesus comes up in you as life. But if you don't acknowledge the death, there's no life. Because life comes out of death. Amen? All right. So beginning in verse 21, and here we begin to see the importance of death, that God operates through death, and it's very important to him. Verse 21, then Martha said unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. There would have been no death. Now listen. Everybody listen. Thank you, John, for listening. I believe you got it because you're shining with what I feel in my heart over this. If you had been here, there would have been no death. Remember, this is the guy who stayed back intentionally so that he would die. But she doesn't understand that. She goes, oh, what, you know, what happened? Traffic? Was it bad camel traffic trying to get here? You know, a lot of camels on the road this week, you know? No, it wasn't bad camel traffic. It wasn't, well, oh, you know, I had to go down. It took me forever to get out of Walmart. No, Jesus said, where the scripture says, when he heard it, he stayed there two more days. He did it on purpose. Why? Well, this we've already read that, so let's read a little further. Verse 22, but I know, this is still Martha talking, but I know. What do you know about Jesus? What do you know, Martha? Spit it out, girl. I know that even now, this is her knowledge of Jesus. She didn't know his heart yet. She didn't sit at his feet like Mary did, her sister. But I know even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask God, God will give it to you. And God can give you, because here's what I know. I know God can give you, release through you, Jesus, miraculous power to reverse death. I have faith. We can stop this demonic attack against my brother. Ho! Jesus is going, there's no demonic attack going on here. I chose not to even put the name of the devil in this chapter. Because if it was in there anywhere, even unrelated, you'd go, see? See that word? Devil. Devil. Devil? Bad. Devil bad. Jesus good. So all we see is that the devil put Jesus to death. Folks, the devil didn't put Jesus to death. Well, then Pontius Pilate did. No, he didn't. Jesus said to Pontius Pilate, you have no power except to be given of God. Said, well, he's apparently giving it to me because I'm about to hang you on a cross, sucker. And did. And he died. This is a tragedy. It's the same kind of situation. This is a tragedy. No, it's not a tragedy. This is, if you'll stick with it, you'll see the glory of God, which, by the way, is written in this chapter. We'll see that, I guess, I assume. So in verse 23, Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Look at that. Our doctrines are obscuring the Lamb. Am I right or wrong? That's a typical doctrine being used to circumvent the reality of Lamb. The reality of death. That through death, he destroyed him that had the power of death. That is the devil. Through death. That through death, the old man is crucified. I am crucified under the world, taking care of the world. Everything is dealt with by death. But if we can't use our, you know, I know even now, you got the power to reverse what you did. Except we don't know that, see, because we don't understand his heart. I'm not talking about his theology. I'll show you his heart in a minute. She said, I have faith. Well, now, since he's not going to work a miracle, I know he will be raised in the last day. And she is literally putting up a wall between her and Jesus, unknowingly putting up a wall of doctrinal truth that to her at that moment is greater than Jesus. And especially greater than the thing that's in his heart right now and why this is happening and why it's been released and the glory that he wanted to see released. She doesn't know. You're a miracle worker. Do your thing, man. You've done it for countless others before this day. My brother's laying in that tomb. You need to get in there and you need to do what you do because I believe. If he doesn't do that, she goes, well, at least I got the doctrine, and I'll use it to block any reality of you that is you in your heart and you. Not you, use you, but you the way you are. Verse 25, Jesus saith unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, I am, okay? Okay, now listen carefully to this verse. Please. I mean, I think probably everybody in this room knows this verse. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. How many have never actually heard that said before? Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Raise your hand. It's okay. No, I have. I'm just trying to help you. Okay, then let's look carefully and let's read it the way it's written and not the way our silly minds take us. Verse 25, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, so here's what belief in him is, though he were dead, yet shall he live. But Jesus lives. He just said, I'm the resurrection and the life. And he says, if you believe in me, though you are dead, is he refuting what he just said. Okay, let me try to help you here. Over here he says, I am the resurrection and I'm the life that comes out of resurrection. Over here, he that believes in me who? I am the resurrection and the life. Believe that guy, what he said. But he that believeth in me, though he were dead, because you're the death, yet shall he live. Who's the life? Who's it talking about when it says, yet shall he live? He says, you're dead. I'm the resurrection. You're the death. I'm the life. So we read this, we go, he's the resurrection and the life, and I believe, and therefore, though I was dead, I'm going to live. No, you're not supposed to. It's supposed to be. But what did he say in Galatians 2:20? But Christ liveth in me. That's supposed to be so real that we don't get tripped up by verses that add something that seems, well, that seems different. That seems more true. That he that believeth in him, though he were dead, he will live. And I believe, and I'm going to live. And that, I believe that more than he's the resurrection and the life. That's good. Doctrinally, I believe that. But what's important to me is that I live. Well, that's, by the way, everything I'm saying now is wrong. You're not supposed to be agreeing with that. And I'm getting a lot of amens out there. not really, I was. He would be literally refuting himself within the same sentence. And that's why, see, when Jesus said, this is not unto death, if we don't understand how he thinks, let's just forget how he operates right now. This is the way he thinks. And if we don't understand how he thinks, we're going to get confused and we're going to change up his words and his meanings. And we're going to make him fit what? Doctrine. And in so doing, we're going to wall off the reality of this while we all hold to some belief system that is only brought about by Christ, but is not Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Anybody ever heard that? Didn't say Christ save you. That's the hope of glory. Christ saved you, the hope of glory. No. God's desire has always been that in all things he had the preeminence, and he put him in us so he could be preeminent, but he put him in us so that we could understand our part. Amen. I'm ready to do my part. Your part is to die. Not to die. You're already dead with Christ, but you understand. You understand what I mean. All right. So I wrote, but that preeminent feature, talking about death, that preeminent feature of the Lamb called death is obscured by our doctrines concerning death and resurrection. Sure, absolutely. But that preeminent feature of the Lamb called death is obscured by our doctrines concerning death and resurrection. In our doctrine, resurrection really doesn't glorify our doctrine of resurrection. And our doctrine of resurrection, it really doesn't glorify Jesus as much as it glorifies us. I'll be glorified, right? Resurrection, I'll be glorified. I'll be raised. I'll be glorified. You know? Because that's the way, I mean, you know, we're thankful that he's doing the work, but we're the object. Anybody see that? I mean, that in all things he might have the preeminence. Shame on us. We should just slap our face every time that we read something wrong and go, that's just wrong, buddy. You stop that right now. At least until the end of today when this season passes. So really in resurrection, our understanding of resurrection is we see ourselves resurrected. Okay? Well, folks, spiritually, he is the resurrection and the life. That's a spiritual manifestation that's a spiritual truth that will manifest outwardly in the flesh, but it's just going to be our bodies are raised, and Christ is going to be, we're going to be raised to live forever as his body. But I don't know that we really even understand that, his body, you know. That's just, we say, well, this body here, well, no, that's Christ in his body. Well, this body of believers, we're not a body of believers. We're the body of Christ. But we can pull it off. Let's change this up. This body of believers right here is, what are we leaving out? Jesus has the life. What else are we leaving out? That we're supposed to be dead, See, the only reason why we're not called a carcass is we have life. His name is Jesus. Yes. We're not the carcass of Christ. Well, some of us aren't. I'm not going to call any names, but since Mike Wallace isn't here, not really. I'm just teasing. All right, so... And when it comes to resurrection, why are we going to be resurrected? Well, it's because I've been in good standing with Jesus. I'm going to be resurrected because I've been a Christian. I've been good. And I've been living for God. You know what I do? I pray over some meals. And I read my Bible every... every day, every whoop. I read my Bible every year at some juncture. See? Therefore, I'm going to be raised. See? How ridiculous is that? You're going to be raised because you died with Christ, and Christ is the resurrection. And it says that we have been raised up and made to sit together in Christ Jesus, that we've been raised up with Christ. So that's in oneness of accord with Christ, not him. See, here's how we see resurrection. If we could throw up a picture of resurrection here, we would be back, back from it. And let's say that we're overlooking a graveyard. And we'd see all these people shooting up out of the grave. Like little rockets. Woo! Look at that! We're raised! You be honest with me. Is that greater in your heart than being one with Jesus and raised when he was raised? And now he's your resurrection. And you're solid in that. You're not Martha. Well, I know her. When the last day he'll shoot up out of the grave. It's going to be harder for him than some because he's in a rock tomb, but I'm sure he'll shoot up. God. You say, why do you get so excited, Randy? Why do you make such a big deal out of this? Because it's the difference between Christianity and Christ. It's the difference between our doctrines that block us and make us where we see all these pictures of stuff that are about us. And instead of him be glorified in the thing, we're going to be glorified. This is going to be the big day. The big day is, today I'm going to be the rocket man. Jesus is going to, and I'm going to, I just hope I have a cape when he comes back. And somebody beside me going up still has their camera, their video. Yeah. When I get to heaven, I'm going to post it on Facebook. I don't know where this stuff comes from. I generally don't. And I'm usually just as surprised as you are. So, yeah, maybe a little more embarrassed than you are. But okay, let's start at verse 28 now. And when she had said so, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, the master is come and calleth for thee. Okay, so I want you to, as we get into this, I want you to see that Jesus' approach and way with Martha is different than with Mary. Okay, it is different. And why am I saying that? It'll mean more when we get into it and you really see it. Why am I saying that? Because relationships matter to Jesus. It doesn't make any, you know, it said Jesus loves Martha and Lazarus, and it didn't even use Mary's name. It said he loves Martha and her sister. He didn't say that he loves Mary more than the rest, but there's a treasure for his heart that has taken place two different times up to this point. And she was at his feet. And one of them is the alabaster box that we've spent so much time emphasizing. Verse 29, as soon as she heard that, she arose. This is talking about Mary. As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. Verse 32, then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. Two times before this, she had fallen down at his feet. But this time it's so different. This time it is completely different than the other two times. The first time, when Jesus was in Martha and Mary's house and Lazarus, Martha's cooking, Mary's sitting at his feet, and there she catches wind. And even if that moment she doesn't, Jesus is planting seeds in her, and the way the scripture is written, there could have been 100 other people sitting there at his feet, but it only mentions her. And you know why it does? Because that's the only one Jesus remembers. Because she was good ground. Because she was more in trying to tune into his heart and not just, oh, let's see, where's that in the word, what you just said, Jesus? And, you know, I want to please you and I want to do all this, instead of wanting to please him, which her heart started going after. And then she leaves, and then the other situation happens where she's in a Pharisee's house, and she comes in and she breaks this expensive alabaster box. And she pours it on Jesus, and she cries, she weeps over him. Why, my God, no one can tell you why. I can only tell you that some reality of him, not what he does, because everybody knew what he does, some reality of him really got to her, and she realized, oh my Lord, this guy's not like other people. He is completely different. And she starts pouring, you know, alabaster box, yes, perfume, yes, fills the room. I personally, you know, you already know that I think that Jesus was the true fragrance of God there. But I personally think those tears on his feet and her wiping his feet and cleansing them with her hair was more precious than the ointment he smelled in that room. It spoke more even. Oh, sure, all the other guys go, that's costly, and you shouldn't be using that for that. We got a lot of ministry stuff that needs to go into. We got a worldwide ministry. All they noticed was the ointment that cost a lot. Because we notice the financial end of it. We notice the business end of the thing. We notice the ministry. But she's past all of that. But this time, she comes in. She falls at his feet. And Jesus hasn't heard a word out of her mouth yet. He just remembers her from two times before. And then this comes out of her mouth. Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. First of all, Jesus ordered that death. Can I get an amen? So she hadn't said anything any different than what Martha said. She's not any further along when it applies to her personally and her, you understand? This is, okay, if this is going to affect me personally, then I'm going to be in the soul. Then my approach is going to be a soulish one. And I'm going to forget everything that I saw of you and heard from you. I believe that Jesus expected her to approach him on a different basis. I really believe that. I believe it with all my heart, and I believe that what we're about to find out here is the proof of that. She's speaking the words even right here. She's saying that basically the same thing that Martha said. And all of them, it is grief over their loss and death and over their suffering and over their tears and over, that's all it is. It's just grief over their life down here. And I'm going to tell you, I mean, I'll say it again. Jesus ordered this death. He could have stopped it, but there are purposes at work here that are eternal, and we are supposed to be with him. Does anybody? We're supposed to be with him, and yet no, we're just living, and we trample his heart, but we never know it. In fact, next time you see him, he'll probably just bless you. You know, and love you, and you'll just won't know. In verse 33, when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, when Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. She brought trouble to the being of Jesus, to his being. She brought, out of all of them, she brought trouble. And she brought groaning. You know, I don't know how to describe groaning. I know that it can be a very deep mourning or disruption in your being because something's just, you can't even put it into words. And he's troubled. He came to show forth the glory of God through death. And she spoke, and she tore down everything that he thought she'd had. Verse 34 and 35, and said, where have you laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Verse 35, Jesus wept. Now, she hasn't just troubled him, she's hurt him. She has brought him to tears. And I believe that he had hoped that that she would have opened the eyes of others to his heart. I believe that's true. I believe that she, and I'll show you that in just a minute, but I believe that he was hoping also that by this time she had opened the eyes of others to his heart, to him, the way that he is, to this spirit, that this was the avenue, that this was the bride, that this was it. Verse 36, then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. And some of them said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? There, Jesus, therefore, again, groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. And it was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. One says how he loved him. It's almost a soulish thing. You would never say that if you knew that Jesus held back so that he would die. And your assumption is that he loves him because he came and he was dead not realizing. If you really understood what Jesus did, you would never have said that. You'd probably said Jesus doesn't love him. And the other one said, and some others said, and some of them said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? You would think with all the power we've seen in our lifetime since Jesus has been on the planet that he could have circumvented death in someone that he loves, that they would not have to go through death, whether it's physical or spiritual, as Paul called it, in deaths often. No, you wouldn't think that. I mean, that's what they're saying. You know, couldn't this, would you think this man could do this? No, you shouldn't think that. You shouldn't think that. You should think what he thinks. You should know him. You should ask, even if not outwardly, you should ask always when it's about him, where are you coming from? What is your heart? I'm constantly running into scriptures and going, I have no clue what that means. And I bet you it doesn't mean what most of us think it means. I need to hear from you and I need the Holy Spirit to bring my heart into Jesus' heart, not just teach me some stuff so I go, hey, look how spiritual I am. Let me tell you what the Lord showed me. No, and miss his heart again. Just miss it. It's constantly missing his heart because it's about me. If it's not about getting me out of my circumstances or whatever, it's make me spiritual. Make me see something that is impressive. That's the whole key to this woman with the alabaster box. She would just wanted to see his heart. She just wanted to communicate, I've seen what you're about, and I'm preparing you for your burial. I'm with you in it. I understand what you're like, and I am with you in it. And the disciples are going, well, look, we need that. We need that stuff. What do you mean, burial? 2 days. In 2 days, Jesus is going to be dead. What do you mean burial? We got a long, ministry here. And it's going to be a good one because Jesus not only can heal people, he can raise the dead. And not only that, he can feed huge multitudes. I mean, we got a guy that can, if we die, he'll raise us up. If we don't have food, he'll make it, appear. We have got a big, glorious, whoopee time ahead of us. 2 days later, they're running and hiding. I don't understand this. It's confusing. What did that girl say? Something about bear. What? I don't know, man. It's just messing with my mind. Jesus doesn't want to mess with your mind. He wants to renew it. So Jesus groans again, it says here. It says again. Jesus groaned again. And no one is seeing this tragedy. It's not a tragedy, but no one's seeing this tragedy in the light of his view, his seeing, his light. His light is how he sees. It's not just something that shoots out. He sees by light. We're darkness. We're in darkness. We are. When we're blind and we totally cannot understand any of these things unless the Holy Spirit opens our eyes. And the best way to get to that point is to say, I am blind. I am totally blind. If you don't open my eyes, I'm going to read this like everybody else, and I'll be Martha. Or worse, I'll be Mary and come in there and say something that rips at his heart. My point about Mary is that Jesus, that relationship, that thing that happened there, and just the flowing of being able to feed her when Mary's saying, get up, you know, and to put seed into her, to put his seed into her. That was a big deal to him. It was, or he would, you read it, he wouldn't have wept. He wouldn't have been troubled. At what point did he get troubled? It doesn't say, well, you know, when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he got troubled and fell down on the bed for 2 days and just couldn't get over it. No, it doesn't say that. It doesn't say when Martha came to him and said the same words that Mary said, that he was troubled, or he wept, or he groaned. It doesn't say that with them. I'm telling you, to the Lord, relationships matter. And we just live like we're just people down here on the earth. I'm just a Christian trying to do the best I can. I'm a churchgoer. I'm a Bible school. And it meant something to him so deep that it brought him to tears. They don't know what I'm doing. They don't know my mind. They don't understand death. They don't see like I see. They're saying, if you'd have been here, what took you so long? Why aren't you with us where we're at in this earth? That's your typical Christian mindset right there. Verse 31, the Jews then which were with her in the house and comforted her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, she goeth unto the grave to weep. Of course, she's going to Jesus, right? Okay. Apparently, the Jews had been with her for a while. And read it. The Jews that then which were with her in the house and comforted her, when they saw Mary get up, they arose and hastily went out and followed her, right? Is that what it says? So they'd been with her for a while. They stayed with her. They followed her to Jesus. That's the progression right there. But when she arrived to Jesus, she showed nothing of him to them. She showed nothing of his heart like she did here. She showed nothing of that. And their view, those same Jews that followed her, their view of why Jesus wept proves that she had shown nothing of what this whole thing of the alabaster box was about. All right. So I've meditated on this before in John 11. I thought, okay, when Jesus showed up, Martha figured it out before he actually even got to the place. She met him, you know, outside the town or something. Doesn't say she had a multitude. Doesn't say she had a bunch of people with her, does it? Doesn't. It's kind of funny that it says that all these Jews are there with her, and then they're comforting Mary. You got to remember this. Maybe you forgot this. Mary of Bethany was a prostitute. All right. Now, a very holy religious man would go, why are all these people comforting a prostitute instead of Martha? There's something shady here. That's what they'd say. But Jesus said, I'm going to make sure that when my word is written, it's going to note that she had plenty of people around her that she could have communicated this spirit of the alabaster box, and that it's about him. It's not about us. It's not about us for him. It's about his heart. It's about him. See? Jesus made sure that there was plenty of information, and that when they spoke, that they spoke the same kind of stuff that she spoke, that Martha spoke, that everybody spoke, that she didn't communicate the things that she had seen of his heart. I wrote down, what could she have shown? What could she have shown to them by this point before all this happened? That he's a lamb? I did this thing for his burial just a few days ago, actually. That it is right to honor him in his burial or in death, or to understand death, or to see death not as the worst thing that ever happened, but that this, I'm pouring the most costly thing out upon him, this alabaster box, in joy, but I am moved by his heart and his self-giving. Verse 25 says, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. She could have showed that death, when approached by the Lamb, equals life to others. She could have, but, you know, because this is a death situation. And, you know, I hate to say this, but we're going to go just a little longer here. I mean, everybody looks fine and everything. You seem listening. But there's a point that I need to make at the end of this. And it's not good that I stop before we get to that point. She could have showed that when he orders death, it is so the Son of God will be glorified. And nobody's seeing him or glorifying him. They're questioning him, or they're saying, why weren't you here? Or, you know, and their doctrines again are not only standing in the way of him, they're somewhat accusing him, because you were our key, you were our answer, you were the one that, you should have been here for my brother, our brother. Why weren't you here? And there's this general view that everybody takes when they get into these kind of situations, and they're not with Jesus and they're not with his heart. So I want to go back up. Let's go look at verse 5. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place. He abode 2 days still. Now look at verse 17. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain, this is talking about Lazarus, Lazarus had lain in the grave 4 days already. Jesus says, open up the tomb, roll the stone away, and they go, man, he stinks already. He's been dead for 4 days. We're not Egyptians. We don't know how to embalm. This is not a good thing. It's not only death, it's stinky. You know, anybody ever been in a situation like that? A lot of death and stinkiness going on. But again, Jesus made sure that death took place. Now, let's look at verse 7 and 8. Then after that saith he to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. His disciples saying to him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? They're worried about death. Anybody following this? This is right in line. And everything that's going to be said after this is going to be so incredibly right in line. But those disciples that missed it here at the alabaster box, miss it here also. Somebody needs to pursue his heart. Somebody needs to get past our doctrines. Somebody needs to care enough to press in. Verse 7, didn't I just read this? Yes. Okay, so the subject is still death. There's no question about that. But this time they're talking about his death and really their death. So now they're going to be worried, right? You know the story. Jesus said, let's go into Judea again. But the disciples are fearful of death. Well, where's Lazarus at? Judea, just outside of Jerusalem, Bethany. I forget, but I think it was like 5 miles back then. You know, that seemed like a lot if you walked. So when Jesus starts talking about going there, they're appalled that Jesus approaches death like this. Well, let's go. And they go, are you, don't you remember? I mean, we could die. Okay, we could die. We wouldn't want to die. Let's stay here and be safe. Let's not put ourselves in a situation where we might have to lay down our life. Verse 9 and 10, of course, Jesus answers. It says the first two words, Jesus answers. So Jesus is answering, listen to this, he's answering their fears concerning death and what's about to take place down there with Martha and all them. Jesus answered. This is an answer. Are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. Basically, he's saying you have to see correctly. And to see correctly, you have to have light. You have to have the right view. This is why he's bringing it. Doesn't it seem weird that this is brought up right in the middle of this story? This little foray. Well, this is exactly what it is. He's talking about you have to have light. If you don't have light, you're going to stumble. If you don't see correctly, then you're going to miss. And he's saying that. He's trying to communicate to that. You guys, you're missing it. But don't worry. I'm going down to Bethany, and there's going to be somebody that's going to be with me in my view. So I wrote down, Jesus sees this situation of Lazarus's death as an opportunity. He sees every kind of loss, death, or suffering as an opportunity. It is the Son of God. It is that the Son of God can be seen and glorified. Instead, we see only the work of the devil. So verse 11, let's read 11 through 14 here. The disciples again are responding. These things said he, and after that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. We don't need to go down there. That's dangerous. Death, you know, if he's asleep, he's not dead, but we will be. If you don't, you know, start thinking the way we think. Howbeit, that's a good one. Howbeit what you said there, brother. Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of rest in sleep. Then Jesus said unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. What? Lazarus is dead. I wrote, the disciples are confused over Jesus' words. Sleep. See, because here's Jesus. He's using sleep because he knows there's going to be life coming. Amen? Life's coming. And it's going to be I am. Y'all be with me. And say, not y'all, but that's what Jesus said. Well, y'all too. And Jesus said that. Y'all be with me. See? Y'all be with me. And see what I see, and you'll see the glory of God. That's all he's asking. He's not asking much, but we have to drop our doctrines, and we have to drop our views, and we have to become blind, and just hold on to Jesus, and just say, I can't see, I don't see, I'll never see unless you open my eyes, and let him do that day after day after day. But you have to have that spirit, because Jesus said, because you say you see, you're blind. That's what Jesus said. What else? The words seem too mild. He's asleep. Jesus, this is a dire situation. Stop using silly, you know, mild words. He's saying, look, you're getting more riled up over this death thing because you don't understand what's going on. That's why you guys are freaking out. And let's see, verse 15. And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Interesting wording here. I mean, there's a bunch of stuff in it. The first part is, I'm glad that I wasn't there. What? You're glad he died? Yeah. You're weird. You love him? Yeah, I love him. You found out he was sick and you stayed back 2 days, right? Right. Took you 2 days to get there, so he was already stinky. And you're glad. Yep. Yeah, this is good. Praise God. You know, I'm with the Father. He's with me. It's Jesus talking there, not me. I'm with the Father. I'm really glad for this situation. Okay. Why are you glad? Why did you let him die? Why? Because it's an opportunity. What? You know, that's what Jesus said. Because this was an opportunity. What? This is an opportunity. Well, he says, to the intent. There's an intention here, to the intent that you may believe. Okay? I want you to understand. I want you to believe in life out of death. I want this to become a regular part of how you see and proceed and everything, because I, you know, and that's what I, you know, don't worry, I'm going to be down there with Mary, and she knows I'm going to be dead soon. She knows it because she did this for my burial. And she comprehends that this is the key. And this is what I came to do. Selfless giving, not self-centered living by my old life for God. But, you know, oh, bless me. Instead of, you do whatever you want with me. I love you. I just want to know your heart when we're in it. That's all I want. No. No, rearrange this, and I don't like the way the furniture and the holy water looks. It's an opportunity. To the intent that you may believe, nevertheless, since you're not getting it, let us go unto him. Nevertheless, I did this so that you might believe. But it doesn't seem like you're getting it. But anyway, it's still, you know, when we get down there, it's going to be better. Verse 16, then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Okay, so we read that and we go, praise God, there's one willing to die. Thanks. Praise God, there's at least somebody that's with Jesus, knows his heart, and is ready to lay down their life. Thank God. They call him Doubting Thomas. Shame on you. Everything I just said is wrong. That is not his view. It's not his view. He didn't understand life out of death. And later he proved that when they said, Jesus is risen from the dead, just like he said. Remember, he said all that. And he goes, I don't believe in life out of death. You know, I believe in puncture wounds. If he shows me the wounds in his hands, I will believe. He doesn't want you to believe circumstances and resurrection in that way. He wants you to believe in life after death. It's not about seeing that and believing. It's about this is the way God operates. And being with him, see, that's the bonus is we get to be with him in the way he thinks and the way he sees and his heart. But if we don't, then we miss it and we miss him. So I wrote here, he is not looking forward to seeing eternal reality concerning the Lamb. Thomas isn't. He's not going, well, let's go with him and watch this really good thing. In fact, he doesn't even speak of Lazarus's death. He only resigns himself to their own death. If we go with Jesus, then we're going to die. All right, let's go with Jesus and die. You know, we'll die with you, Jesus. We're not happy about it, but we'll be with you. Come on, can you see them all 12 walking? All right, we're with you. We love you. We don't want to do it. Don't make us hurt. We have a wrong understanding of death, and I wrote, wrong understanding of what death with Jesus is about. Our death with Christ is so it will be about him, that the Son of God would be glorified. That's what it says. All right, so I'm going to end with reading you a couple of verses here. Amen, y'all ready? Was that because you're ready for me to end or because... You're ready for the verses. Oh, amen. We're ready for you to shut up, brother. See, that's the thing. See, I don't preach, but like we rotate, so you don't get these long sermons except by me. So if you really want to enjoy it, come back when I'm not preaching. All right, Colossians 1, you don't have to turn there. I'll just read it. How about you just listen? Colossians 1, 16 through 19, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and even things you don't see, invisible. Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities and powers. Thrones and dominions or principalities and powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, but now we're going to be before him. Oh, I'm sorry. It doesn't say that. I'm sorry. I don't know where that came from. And he is before all things, and by him all things are held together. And he is the head of the body, the church, and he who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. Why? That in all things he might have, what? The preeminence. For it pleased the Father, that in him should all fullness dwell. Let's stand together. Father, you know how I've prayed long and hard for days for this day that this word would be shared from your heart. I pray that it's not just another sermon. I pray that I have prayed and do pray and will pray that we can shake ourselves from our slumber. We can shake ourselves from our lethargic approach. That we can get up and break through the crowd of disciples and Pharisees and reach your heart and stay with your heart. And stay with your heart. May that those scriptures we read in Colossians not be some sort of doctrinal belief that we believe that. But may we so yearn after you that eventually in all things you will have the preeminence in all things, and that the Father will be pleased that we recognize his preference, that all fullness would dwell in your Son, Father, in Jesus. Father, may this word go out to many, many who have yearned. We have people in other countries, other states, other cities that have been following along. May this word reach them. And then, Father, just my greatest desire is that we could see these verses and in it see your reaction to Mary of Bethany and the deep wounding, the wounding of a heart that is so precious and so gentle, and because she just wasn't with him. The bride wasn't with him where he was at. She wanted to make her own way at that point and weep and mourn. If she knew his heart, if she knew the resurrection and the life, if she knew that his burial, what it was going to lead to, and she knew it in a true way, she would have been with him. So, Father, we ask you to let us learn from these verses. Let us see that he truly cares. He deeply cares about a relationship with us based on these things. Show us, whether through this sharing or some other time, some other means, show us. We ask.